Grammy Award-winning mastering engineer Mandy Parnell invited us to Black Saloon Studios in London to talk us through some of the processes involved in mastering top artists. First, we asked Mandy to describe the role of a mastering engineer in detail.
For me, being a mastering engineer, you're part of the production team. The first port of call is you're a sounding board for the team. So if you imagine that you've got your artist who has spent anything from a few months to a few years working on a project, from demos through to final mixes, you have the mix engineer, the producer, maybe even the manager, A&R involved. They've all been involved in the project for a long time. So when they come to me, I'm, in a sense, the first neutral set of ears. I'm the first sounding board. So that's my first role, is a neutral set of ears on the project. My next role is to take their mix and transfer it, so that hopefully, which it's a bit abstract at the moment because our world's changed so much, it will transfer across to every different medium and work on many different systems. Things have changed a lot because we've got lots of different formats now. In the past few years, we've delivering digital audio, not just CD and vinyl. The different platforms now that have got all different types of limiters coming into them. So, you know, we're in, a bit of a grey area of learning again how things are going to work. And even though everyone's saying things need to be more dynamic, my past year has shown that actually everyone wants it louder than they've ever wanted it. So that's my next role, is to help them transfer their mix to the best of their ability through to the different platforms. So yeah, we work with the production team to realise the dream of the artist, basically.
How does the process work from the arrival of files to delivering the final product?
Generally, we're getting sent digital files. So they're either coming in on a hard drive, or we're downloading them from an FTP site, being sent to us via WeTransfer, Dropbox, or reel-to-reel tape. Or sometimes, you know, if we're doing remastering, they might be off, who knows, vinyl, DAT, up cassette. What I recommend is send me the files at the sample rate that you've mixed it. Don't do anything funny with sample rate conversions. Definitely 24 bits. If you've done listening copies for the production team and record company and managers, PR people, can you send the listening copies along with them? I might get involved artistically if they give me a running order on an album and I don't think it's necessarily working. I'll give my opinion on that. I'll be very honest about what my instincts are with the project, because I feel the teams that are coming to me, that's what they're paying for. They're paying for that, you know, brutal honesty of how I perceive what's going on. And like I say to it, it's not my ego. I don't care. I'm just telling you what I think. I might suggest a remix if I feel that it's not quite working, it could be better. I will work with the mix engineer, artist, producer with that. If I feel that the mixes are really off base and part of it is because the monitoring setup's wrong, if they're in the UK and I will go to a studio and go set the speakers up with them. People think I'm a bit crazy to do these things, but my attitude is if the mixes are better, my mastering's better. Your mastering's only going to be as good as your mix, really. Mm-hmm. There's only so much we can do. So yeah, we need to consider all the different sort of formats, how it's going to sound when it gets codec down, which there's loads of different codecs, which most people don't really understand, that there's not just a MP3, there's, you know, quite a few different ones depending on the platform. So yeah, we have a lot to consider. So it just means, yeah, we have to spend a lot more time at the back end of things, not sitting just mastering tracks, but thinking about what's happening afterwards.
So, what software and hardware does Mandy use to achieve the kind of sound she's looking for?
So the files come in. I have different playback engines. So I'll work with different DAWs. My normal playback is Sadie. That's where I'd normally start. Based on what I'm hearing, what I might want to do with the files, I might decide from there. I might go to Sequoia. I might play it off Logic. Sometimes if we get stems in that have been mixed on Logic, we might play back on Logic. Same with Pro Tools, might play back on Pro Tools. I'll play them back through the Prism 88. It comes out of the Prism into an Analogue EQ. This is my sort of general starting point. I might change it again based on what I'm hearing. The thing is with mastering, nothing's set in stone with what tools you use, but this is my sort of starting playback. So yeah, it's through like an Analogue EQ, then Analogue compressor, valve, that's a valve stage there. Then generally it comes into the desk. So in the desk it comes into the input module, which is a gain stage. Goes into the limiter if I want to use them, into the EQ, more EQ with the filters, more level to the output stage. At the output stage it gets converted back to digital through the ADA8s. Then it will go into digital limiters, so L2, TC, then captured back in, again, either Sequoia or Sadie, depending on what the project is. I generally will master at the sample rate that I'm given and then worry about the different file formats later. And then, you know, I have plugins on both sides of playback and record. Not always, again, dependent. Often I use plugins on playback. If I'm not happy with the mix, it's more clinical what I do with the plugins on the playback side. And then on the record side, more artistic if I'm using plugins. I suppose I'm a bit of a hybrid. I could master in the box. I don't feel that I feel that I get a percentage more space going into Analogue, if that makes sense. I get more depth and a more spatial awareness coming through when I bring it to Analogue, and I have more control, I feel, than working in digital. But some of the tools now in digital are very good. So I have mastered in digital. I use both. For me, it's very dependent on the project, what I'm going to do. I like my Analogue tools. And the way I work a lot is with gain structuring, with pushing levels through different transformers to give different effects, which sometimes is quite hard to do in digital. You know, I'll have to work a lot harder in digital to achieve what I'd probably achieve on here. But I'd probably pretty much get there. I think for me, the tools just make our jobs easier. That's not the crutch of what we do. It's about how we interact with sound. You know, this is just a tool. A lot of it's done with gain at first, actually. You can do a lot with gain. If you think I've got, how many gain stages? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different stages, 8, 9 different gain stages through my system. So yeah, it's little bits here and there and just seeing how the frequencies work and listening to the space of what's going on. So that's how I sort of view things, you know, just because I've got very nice tools, it's because I've picked them and, you know, I can work quickly with them and I know what they do and like what they do, but I do the same whatever you put in front of me. Because it's more based on how I interact with sound rather than, you know, the tools. You see, I'm very much about depth of sound. I grew up from very young listening to Analogue records. Basically, little. My parents had a cafe and they had a jukebox in there, and the guy used to come every week to change the records out and would give me the 7 inches. And, you know, I was like so high, sort of 5, years old, and I'd sit and play record. I was fascinated by records from very young. So I really like that depth of sound that came off these records, and the spatial, there'd be this spatial sort of sound to it, you know, like, yeah, the depth and the space around them. So a lot of what I'm looking for is, you know, about that separation. I feel that's, yeah, that's what I tried to bring, is to get more separation, more defined sound, in a sense. You know? Yeah, I'm looking for the space in between the sounds, you know, and try and, yeah, focus on opening that out more.
We wanted to know if Mandy had any studio secret weapons she could share with us.
My desk is one. I think for me, the biggest life changer was when I bought the Prism converters from what I was working with before. And I try lots of converters when they come onto the market and compare them against my Prism, and yeah, always end up back here. So I think that's a bit of my secret weapon, to be honest with you, is good converters. I think on the Analogue side, definitely the A820 Studers, I really like them. They've got a very, you know, sort of big sound. I like the, yeah. So yeah. But yeah, I think the Prism's definitely on the digital side for me.
And does Mandy have any tips for mix engineers looking to have their work mastered, or for aspiring mastering engineers?
Sometimes, especially now with bedroom producers that are mixing on sort of, you know, sort of small to mid-range monitors, and they don't have the sub. If you think years ago when, you know, I learnt to, you know, to mix and I came into the industry, you'd go into a recording studio, you'd have the big monitors, you'd be able to check the bass, you'd be able to check these things. People don't have that facility anymore. They might be in the sort of bedroom, the room's not treated very well, they really are not in control of what they're hearing. So then it's a very different thing when I'm often asking people to remix because of the bass, because they're not hearing the sub and the sub's too much. So it's often mainly due to a particular frequency range that's very hard sometimes to cut away in mastering and get it to still sound good. I think listen to a lot of music on your systems before you even think about mastering. What a mastering engineer, I mean, it's a long training really to be a mastering engineer. If you think most people that are mastering engineers, start asking them how long they've been doing it. For me, it was about a 5-6 year training before I didn't have to go ask my peers, how do I do this, how do I do that? Then the next 5 years was me getting my chops and getting the trust and starting to work with different production teams. And then after that, that's you building your profile. So you think, I've been in the industry this year 30 years. So a lot of listening, reference a lot, play a lot. You know, I wouldn't spend more than half an hour on a track when you're starting without refreshing your ears on something. So listen to a lot of music, and at different levels, you know, set your levels, you know, a lot. If you watch a lot of master engineers, we'll know where we are just based on our monitor controller. So really be in control, you know, get your settings and stay there. So yeah, but listen to lots of music, that's your key, and think about what they've done.
We asked Mandy to talk us through the mastering process used for Elvis Presley Blues from the latest album by legendary Welsh vocalist Tom Jones.
When I start a beginning session, I would send a 1K tape through from the playback system through the whole chain, all the way through, checking the analogue path and all the way through to the digital path. Just make sure everything's balanced, and yeah, I'm getting the right readings. And again, really to be in control, to know where I am, you know. So when I'm adding level, you know, I know where my starting point was, so I know where I'm going. So I then start to playback, and depending on what I hear would depend on what system I play back, but I always will start with Sadie. So with Tom's project, we play back off Sadie and I captured in Sequoia. And the signal path was the Prism ADA8 for conversion to digital to analog. Through inward connections, EQ, the Esoteric Audio Research Limiter compressors, 660s, into desk, EMI transfer console, captured back through the Prism converter, some Waves L2 hardware, and TC Electronic brick wall limiter. So I have different points on my monitor controller, which, I've set up reference points for listening, and there's a dim button. So I know sort of how loud something is sounding at this point. So I know how loud I'm going to push the system through based on my monitor controller points. When I first start to listen, I listen to basically delivery, I suppose, like we all do, so delivery of the vocal, what the spectrum is, how wide something is, the depth, height. I'll use the different meters around me, so I might put the visualization on so that I've got a spectrum analyzer, a couple of phase meters here, phase meter here, meters on my desk, so VUs. Just reading lots of information that, again, through experience, just is second nature. I don't think about that I'm even doing that. It's just, just what I do. So, listening to sort of delivery, thinking about what I'm hearing. This was an unusual track, one of my favourite ones off the album, but quite unusual, not really what you'd expect from a Tom Jones track. And for me, I really wanted to hear more of his vocal. It's interesting working with Tom Jones because I've listened to him my whole life, from my grandparents to my parents. I mean, his voice is so inbred in all of us without us really knowing. So I suppose for me, that's what I really focused on, was his delivery and trying to get the strength out. So what I'd start with is level. So, I'd look at the output level of my playback system, see where it's peaking, think about how much headroom's there, look at the VUs coming in and base it on there. So I would always, get my level up there first. So I'd start to add level. So based on the gain of the desk, through the limiters. So generally, before I start anything, I would play the whole track through, maybe one, two, maybe three times, who knows, it really depends on the project. Sometimes I might play back something five times. Maybe the first time I understand straight away where I'd like to hear it, if I am going to change something. So again, very dependent on the music. So I start with getting the gain structuring up. And then I think about sort of the spatial stuff, So I mean, it's very warm sounding, it's quite closed sounding, so I'd want to open it up. So often I'll start with the bass end to get more depth and space out of stuff, And often I won't sort of do huge amounts. I think less is more and use more tools, if that makes sense. So little bits here, little bits there, same with level, a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, rather than a lot on one thing. So that you have more control and less scope of changing things, if that makes sense, in relation to the mix. So it's, you know, little bits. So, yeah, let me take that out. So, yeah, I'll add bass end. Normally after a bass I'll look at top end often, yeah? And then we'll come into the mid range, yeah? So throughout each turn I would probably sort of listen to quite a big section. Sometimes what I'll do is I'll take a phrase that I've really tuned into when I've done the playback that's really emotionally moved me, and I might play that phase over a lot and check what I'm doing with the different frequencies on that phase and yeah, how it's going to work. So yeah, with this track, when I mastered it originally, I think I did two versions and picked one afterwards. Often, you know, when I'm working, if I'm not sure, I might do 2-3 versions and then pick a version that I like afterwards, you know, when I can just sort of sit on the sofa and play them, make a decision. I suppose a bit like when you're printing a mix and you're not sure. So after I'm happy with it, then yeah, I'll capture it into Sequoia. And at that point, we'll do the critical listening when we're doing recording, listen on headphones for clicks, dropouts, check for sort of distortions. If we are hearing anything funny, it is on the mix, writing it down, sending it back to mix engineer, producer, see whether they want us to do any restoration. My experience is sometimes some of the movement clicks and things that might disturb us, people might like, so it's better to check rather than just assume to get rid of stuff. So yeah, again, depends on the team of people. But that's, yeah, basically how I'd approach a track. And again, when I'm listening, I'll listen at different levels. So I have my normal sort of listening point where I know how loud it is. I have a loud point, especially if I'm working on some dance stuff that's going to go on to club systems. I have a quiet point, I'll listen on dim. On my monitor controller, I can flick back to hearing just like my analog path, you know, and digital path. So I'll flick between the two of them. To make sure what I'm bringing, especially on the digital side, converting it back, that I'm not losing too much, that maybe I'm not sort of squashing it too much with the limiters. So it was more about opening it out for me and just getting some more depth in sound across the spectrum, basically. Because the minute you start to add any EQ, you change the phase relation inside the mix. So you can, you'll change the shape of the waveform, won't you, of the bass end. So therefore, it'll give us more depth and height, you know, and spatial, you know, by doing that straight away. Any EQ is going to change, you know, your spatial perception, isn't it, on a stereo mix. It's all about vocal level. It's always about vocal. If you've got any track that has a vocal in it, that's what you spend your energy on. It's about the vocal level. So how do you get it to work with everything else? It's probably the reference point would be vocal levels. And the key is really understanding where you are, being in control of your monitor controller, how loud you listen to stuff. So when I changed the setup in here and put the surround system in, and got this monitor controller in. You know, I spent, I don't know, maybe 3 days just, you know, with measurement tools, measuring, you know, and with just listening to a lot and setting up my monitor levels. So yeah, just that's your control point. If you've listened to lots of music that are already mastered, that are already out there, that have done really well, whatever that people talk about, and you listen to them in your studio, set up your monitor controller where you're not going to hurt your ears listening at that level, and just being in control of how something sounds at a particular point. And that's your biggest control, basically. And then you reference from there. And like for, you know, how he's going to have lots of stuff that he's going to reference when he starts. When you start, you reference a lot. When we were at the exchange, you'd often start your day by coming in, setting the room up and sitting there and listening to music for half an hour before your clients came in. So that you'd be in control. It's about control of your environment, you know. The more in control you are, the better.
If you like this video, subscribe to the Sound on Sound YouTube channel for all our latest video content. Also, you can find the magazine in your local newsagent, download the tablet edition, or find us online at soundonsound.com. Thanks for watching.